welcome to the Eating Disorder Recovery Podcast.
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 Welcome to the Eating Disorder Recovery Podcast with me, Dr. Janine Anderson. Heads up, this show may contain adult language and may mention specific foods. If you find either of those to be too triggering, I trust you to take care of yourself and do what you need to do. This podcast is sponsored by Ipono Maui and ED Care. Ipono Maui is led by internationally renowned expert on eating disorders, Dr. Anita Johnston. Located in a home-like oceanfront facility in beautiful Maui, Hawaii, Ipono offers residential, partial hospitalization, and intensive outpatient treatment for eating disorders. Visit iponomaui.com, spelled A-I-P-O-N-O-M-A-U-I, to learn more. ED Care has provided PHP, IOP, and outpatient treatment for all genders 18 and over since 2001. CAMHSA, which stands for Connection, Acceptance, Mindfulness, Sense of Self, and Action, is ED Care's mindfulness-based treatment approach and is incorporated into each individualized treatment plan. Facilities are located in Denver, Colorado Springs, and Kansas City, and all treatment is supported by master's-level clinicians or higher. ED Care offers four specialty tracks for binge eating disorder, elite athletes, substance use, and trauma. And the Connections House, an affordable, supportive housing component, adds an extra layer of supervised support. Visit eatingdisorder.care or call 866-771-0861. Judith Matz, LCSW, is co-author of Beyond a Shadow of a Diet, the comprehensive guide to treating binge eating disorder, compulsive eating, and emotional overeating, and the Diet Survivor's Handbook, 60 Lessons in Eating, Acceptance, and Self-Care, and the author of Amanda's Big Dream. Judith has a private practice in Skokie, Illinois, and is a popular public speaker at local and national conferences. Descriptions of her work have appeared in media including Allure, New York Times, LA Times, Fitness, Self, Shape, Today's Dietitian, Diabetes Self-Management, Psychotherapy Networker, NBC News Chicago, Huffington Post Live, and she appears in the documentary America the Beautiful 2. Please welcome Judith Matz.
Hello, Judith. Thank you for being here.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Nice to talk with you.
I'm so excited to have this chat with you today. First, tell us a little bit about your background, maybe your books, and kind of how you came to this work in the field.
Oh, sure. Well, you know, I'm a clinical social worker, so I have a private practice doing individual therapy with people. And most of the people who come to me struggle with overeating in some way, whether it's what we call emotional overeating or binge eating disorder. And so I do a lot of work with helping people break the diet binge cycle. And I came to this work when I was in graduate school. I started training, doing some postgraduate work, and I was on an eating disorders team. And while I was on that team, I started working with, of all things, I'm embarrassed to say it now, but with the OptiFast program, which is one of those liquid fast programs in the 1980s. I know that may surprise you, but that's what Oprah was doing at the time, and it was very popular, and I was doing the psychological groups where I was helping people learn new habits, new ways of thinking as they were on this liquid fast, drinking these awful-tasting shakes for 3 months. I mean, talk about willpower, right?
Right. But, torture.
And people lost a tremendous amount of weight. But what I saw is that just like with any diet, when it was over, regardless of how much time, money, energy they put into it, the weight came back for just about everybody. But actually, there were some people who were successful by society's terms in that they kept the weight off. And for those people, in order to keep it off, Janine, they were doing things like over-exercising. They had to write down every single thing that they ate. Mm. If they went to a party and there was a food they hadn't planned for, they were in a panic.
Yeah.
And I reached this point where I thought, if this is what I'm helping people to do, stay obsessed with food and body, I don't want to have any part of it. And around that time, I read one of the first non-diet books, Overcoming Overeating by Jane Hirschman and Carol Munter. And they talked about how it was the deprivation of dieting that actually caused so much of the overeating that people experience. And when I read that book, not only did it resonate professionally, but it actually brought me back to my own personal experience, which is, you know, that when I was in high school, I started dieting. And, you know, for those of you who don't know me and my work, I'm actually really short. I'm under 5 feet and I'm a small person, but I was afraid of getting fat. I had a boyfriend who said, "You're so thin." And I thought, well, if thin is good, isn't thinner better? Mm. And all the girls I knew were dieting and I wanted to be part of the club. So I would do things like eat plain yogurt that I hated. I mean, I didn't enjoy it at all. And I would add sweetened milk and make it in cinnamon to try to make it better. Mm. I remember my mom cooking dinner one night. She was making meatloaf and it smelled delicious. And I stayed in my room with the door shut. Mm. And, you know, thinking, okay, I'm really in control now, like feeling virtuous. And for people out there who have dieted, you know that virtuous feeling comes, that when you're able to not eat the things you decide you shouldn't eat. And so I went on that way for a bit, except for the first time in my life, I now started to binge. I was binging on strawberry frosting, like eating a whole can, on cheesecake, on all the foods I was trying to avoid. And that followed me through college. In the dorm, I would try to only eat the salad bar with diet dressing, and then I would binge on, you know, the desserts later at night. And even into grad school, and then I had this experience. It was a summer between grad school and in the Chicago area, and it was right before I moved back to Chicago. I took a summer, and I was living in Boston. I was in this studio that had no scale and no mirror, and I had gotten a job at Legal Seafood and Restaurant. Some people out there might know that restaurant. It's very popular. And I was so sick of dieting at this point, I just said, forget it. For the summer, I'm just not going to deal with it. And I went back to actually the way I was raised eating. I eat when I'm hungry, eating what I wanted. I mean, here I was at Legal Seafood, and there was all this delicious food, seafood, desserts, all kinds of things. But once I could have it, and I wasn't telling myself it was bad, it just became food for me again. And you know, I haven't mentioned, but during this time of dieting, I actually gained weight for the first time. So all the dieting resulted in binging, weight gain. And when I returned to Chicago, I was back to what was a normal weight for me, for my body. And it just clicked that it was all the dieting, all the deprivation that was actually triggering this overeating. And I made myself a promise right then that if I ever thought I shouldn't eat something because I thought it was bad, too fattening, I would have it to prove to myself I could. So that was my experience over those few years. And, you know, once I made myself that promise, I didn't struggle anymore. I was never an emotional overeater. I was never relying on food for feelings. And so that was it. I kind of went on with my life. I was working in a mental health center. I started seeing my first client who was struggling with the overeating. And being a therapist, you know, we're trained to understand the whys. Why does somebody feel this way? What's getting in the way of good relationships? And so when she was struggling with overeating, it was like, well, what's going on? You know, why is she reaching for food? And we did great work around looking at, you know, improving her self-esteem and being able to get into an intimate relationship for the first time, choosing a career path. And that was all great, but her eating didn't change. Mm-hmm. And when I read Overcoming Overeating and through my experience with OptiFast, it really clicked for me that it's not enough as a therapist. Like, we can understand all the emotional reasons in the world, but you still have to help people really learn how to break into the diet binge cycle. And so I, at that point, referred that particular client to a colleague who was doing that work. And then she was finally able to establish a better relationship with food and end her overeating. And that's the kind of work I continue to do with the clients that come to me. And that's what, you know, we wrote the books Beyond the Shadow of a Diet, which was our first book, and it's meant for mental health and even dietitians, people who are providing services. And then we wrote Diet Survivor's Handbook for people out there who are struggling with overeating, breaking the diet binge cycle, wanting to feel better in their body and to learn good self-care. So that's a long way of telling you.
No, I love it. I love it. And of course, I will link to your books in the show notes like I always do. So everybody listening will be able to get to them very easily. I guess just to break it down even further and get into the nitty gritty, like, what's so harmful about dieting?
Okay, well, let's just go through how the diet binge cycle looks. Like, nobody ever wakes up in the morning and says, gee, I look terrific. I think I'll go on a diet.
Right. Right.
It's always, oh, my thighs are too big, my stomach's too fat, you know, all that negative talk, or even I'm not healthy enough. Whatever it is you're saying, you make a decision that something's not okay with your body and you better do something about it. And so you can choose from all kinds of plans out there, low calorie, low fat, low carb. These days it's going gluten-free, going paleo, eating clean. There's all kinds of words, and many of them are diets in disguise. I'm not dieting, I'm just eating healthy. But whenever you're manipulating food for the purpose of weight loss, that's a diet. And so, you go on the diet and, for a week, 6 weeks, maybe even 6 months, you feel good. You know, that feeling I talked about earlier, it's like you're on a high, you feel virtuous. I'm in control. I've got it this time. And that feels great, right? And so you have to wonder why, and you may even start to see weight loss and people come up to you and they're complimenting you. So you have to wonder, if it feels so good, how is it that the vast majority, upwards of 95% of people who go on diets eventually go off them and gain the weight back? And what we always talk about is you haven't failed your diet. Your diet has failed you. So why is that? All right, so we have I'm too fat, I need to lose weight. You go on the diet, and then there are physiological and psychological reasons that move you in the direction of rebelling against your diet. If I said to you, starting tomorrow, you can never have ice cream again, what are you going to do?
I would be so sad, and I would think about ice cream nonstop. And I would probably eat a bunch of ice cream tonight in total Last Supper mentality to get it all in.
Yeah, and that's the reaction I get. When I do workshops and ask that question, just about everybody says, yeah, I'd eat it. I'd go out and eat it tonight. And they would eat it whether they were hungry for it or not, and they would eat more of it than their body needs. And so that's the setup. Whether you're actually on a diet or even anticipating a diet, when we're told we can't have something, we say, don't think about a pink elephant, you can't help but think about a pink elephant.
Mm-hmm. That's how brains work.
Yeah, it's how our brains work. So psychologically, the more we try to limit something, the more we're going to become preoccupied with it. Physiologically, when you think back to our ancestors way, way back, it was feast or famine. And in times of feast, the metabolism can speed up and calories can be, burned up. But in times of famine, the body would slow down and hold on to every calorie, not to make you fatter, but to help you survive. The physiology we write about in the books, I'm not going to go into all the physiology, but it's like when you start to diet, your body sends out these warnings, that you're in trouble, and it's trying to help you by holding on to calories, by getting better at storing fat, so literally changing your physiology. And when you break through the diet, and chances are you will, you've lost some fat, but you've also lost muscle, but what you're gaining back is fat. And muscle is what's the part of your body that's metabolically active. So, what we see is that the more people diet, the higher their weight goes over time. In a sense, they're raising their set point. Your set point is where you naturally fall when you're eating in a way that, when you're hungry, stopping when you're full, have activity in your life that is reasonable for you. Your body has like a range that it's going to fall in. And our weight regulation system is really outside of our conscious control. So when you try to jiggle with it, it changes. Your set point goes up in theory to protect you, even though, of course, the weight gain is upsetting. So then what happens? So you've broken through the diet, your restrictions. And when you do, you're not going for carrots and salad and apples, right? You're going for the very foods that you said were the, quote, bad foods or the forbidden foods. And so the weight gain comes back, and then what happens is, I think the most insidious part of this whole thing is the shame. Mm-hmm. Because up until now, you were losing weight, and you're getting compliments, and you feel good, and you gain back the weight, and everybody is silent.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a very, very painful place to be. And so what happens? You start to say, gosh, this feels terrible. I better do something about it. And the next diet begins and the whole cycle. And this can go on for years and for decades. I'll have people come to me in their 40s, 50s, 60s who've been doing this since they were teens. So I would encourage anybody out there who's listening and who's caught in this cycle, first to remember you're not alone and it's not your fault.
Mm-hmm.
And that it is possible to break out of this cycle, and the sooner you do it, the better.
Yeah, I love what you said, because I just know from my own clinical work that there are so many people who I've worked with who just feel like they are bad at dieting. Like if they could just be better at dieting, they wouldn't have these problems. And, you know, instead you're really speaking to the fact that diets themselves are the problem. They don't work for upwards of 95% of people. So
if you're somebody who uses birth control and you went to your gynecologist and said, I need birth control. And she or he said, well, here's one. Here's a 5 to 10% chance it'll work.
We'd have problems.
We'd have problems, right? And you would be like, what? You know, and yet people, you know, they keep blaming themselves. And part of the problem, Janine, is that diets work in the short term. I mean, that's part of the problem here, is that any diet, you can do anything just about, and you'll see some short-term weight loss. So you think, well, I lost it. Why can't I keep it up? It must be my fault. And you don't understand the physiological forces at play that ensure that it will come back for most people. You know, again, there's a small percentage of people. But I always say, if you're one of those people, you know it by now, because usually people are repeat dieters. If you're getting in that repeat cycle, you're not that person. And you can think you're going to become it, but you're spinning your wheels, you know, and it's time to really learn a different way of feeding yourself, of, you know, because it's not enough to just say, I'm not going to diet. You then have to learn how to break the diet mentality and what to do instead.
So if diets are so ineffective, what's your take on why they're so pervasive and why people feel compelled to do them again and again?
Well, isn't that a great question?
Because I know it's kind of loaded.
I want to just emphasize that first part. Like, in the short term, they work. And so people then blame themselves when it fails. But I think that the issue is so much bigger than that. We live in a diet culture. We live in a culture where disordered eating is normative, like skipping meals or, you know, cutting out major food groups. All of that is considered okay in the pursuit of, you know, weight loss and in theory, in pursuit of health. But, you know, at the core of this, there is so much weight stigma out there. Being at higher weight is seen as there's something, you know, it's shameful. There's something wrong with you. You're out of control. And conversely, right, being thin promises everything. You have to be thin to be happy, to be successful, to be sexy, to be healthy. So if the message is, especially if young kids are growing up with the message, hey, if you want to be happy in your life, you need to be thin. Well, you know, and especially then things in your life aren't going great. And it's like, okay, well, I can't control my boss being mean to me, or I can't control that my partner broke up with me, but I can control my body. I can control my food, you know, becomes a substitute. So there's so many psychological, social, economic forces. It's a huge business. You know, diet companies count on those repeats, right? I mean, gosh, look what's happening with Weight Watchers. You know, and now we have Oprah backing it and saying it's not a diet, but it's a diet. Anytime the goal is weight loss, it is a diet. And it's subject to the same pitfalls that I've been talking about.
Absolutely. Side note, she owns a lot of stock in Weight Watchers. So if I were in that position, I'd probably feel pretty motivated to present that as something that works as well. In all of your years of clinical experience working with clients who are trying to let go of the diet mentality, what do you notice the emotional or psychological effects of chronic dieting is on people?
Gosh, it's making me think about somebody that I've been working with for a few months who came to me because nobody can figure out why she's not losing weight because she's been such a, quote, good dieter. Now, the result of her dieting is she has these binges, right? And so this belief on her part that the binges must be why she's not losing weight, and so she's coming to me to stop the binging. All these foods have been cut out, and she's terrified of them. And, you know, you're asking about the psychological and emotional impact for her, and I think for just about everybody who gets involved in dieting, chronic dieting. It's a preoccupation every day of your life. Is it going to be a good day? Is it going to be a bad day? Was I good? Was I bad? Right? I mean, and you're either being good and often feeling deprived. So for her, she's at parties or out to dinner, and she feels so different. Other people are enjoying their food, but she can't order those things, right? I mean, she has to order the things that are on her food plan. And so it's been so neat to watch, because as she is incorporating more food, so we're working on ending dieting and being able to identify her when she's hungry, and for the first time in like 30 years, asking, what am I actually hungry for? Like, what will satisfy me? And it's confusing to her still, because she hasn't allowed herself to think about that in so long, so she's really disconnected from her body. But what's been neat is she's gone to some events lately where she has had what everybody else is having, or ordered from the menu something she thought would be good, and she feels part of the gang.
Yeah.
And I think that's so wonderful to watch. And I always ask people to think about, like, breaking the diet mentality is really challenging. Those patterns get very ingrained for you if you've been dieting. And some of you listening may have grown up with this in your families. Like,
I definitely did. Yeah.
You did, right. Yeah. So food's classified as good and bad, right? And so it's really hard to then not see a brownie as bad when you've been raised to think sweets are bad. And what I really emphasize to people is to try to shift from thinking about food as good and bad to what feels good and what feels bad. Because, like, let's just say we're talking about after dinner, you still want a little something sweet. And there might be a time, like in Chicago today, it's really hot. And, you know, somebody might after dinner think, I want something sweet, but brownie feels too heavy. An apple would feel really good. Okay, so they have the apple and it feels good. But on another day, when they're in the mood for something sweet, and they have an apple, it might feel bad, like it's too light. Like, a brownie is what feels good. And that's what's key, is to start to listen to your own body to tell you what you need in that moment. So there are times when an apple can feel good and an apple can feel bad, and there's times when brownies can feel good and when brownies can feel bad. Can you tell the difference? How do you start to experiment when you're hungry and really think about, how will this food not only taste, how will it feel in my body? How will I feel after I eat it, but also 15, 20 minutes from now? How will my stomach feel? How will my energy level be? You know, whatever things help you know, am I comfortable? Am I where I want to be? As I say this, I just want to point out that our bodies like variety. I have never met anyone who only wants ice cream and cookies and cake and candy and pizza or chips, but I've also never met anybody who only wants carrots and salads and fruit. Our bodies like variety. So the key to breaking the diet binge cycle is to first identify hunger, but then to start to really pay attention to how foods feel in your body, to give yourself permission. That's the key, is the permission to eat what you're hungry for when you're hungry.
I think that that's a brilliant point that you made, that we have to start thinking about it in not such simplistic terms as to say this food is good or this food is bad, but to be thinking about making a good match for what you need at any given point in time.
Exactly.
What other steps can we take if we have listeners out there who are thinking, yeah, maybe I don't want to be dieting so much?
Well, let's start with this. If you feel scared to give up dieting, that's normal.
Yep.
And you might feel excited and relieved at the idea. So you can have a bunch of different feelings about it. And when you make the decision to give up dieting, well, first of all, chances are for most people who are, you know, I'm talking about the diet binge cycle. So there are some people who restrict and they manage to keep restricting. And so I'm really not talking about that group. I'm talking about the majority of people who diet and then break through the restriction and binge. And some of them may meet the criteria for binge eating disorder, or for some it may be overeating, and I don't know how much you want to go into that. So people might initially feel scared at the idea of letting go of diets. And that makes sense, because for months, years, maybe even decades, you have been counting on some external rules and regulations to help you decide when, what, and how much to eat. And part of what that's done is disconnect you from your body. And in a sense, giving you the message, you can't trust your body. You can't be trusted, so you have to follow somebody else's ideas about how to go about eating. So what we're talking about is moving from external rules to an internal decisions to guide you. And so it's not going to be smooth sailing. Like, people don't just transition from, I'm a dieter, to, oh, okay, I'll just stop dieting. If you can do that, you're not stuck in the diet binge cycle.
Right.
It takes work, and it takes patience. You know, these patterns developed over time, and it takes time to undo them. And especially, in the, you know, like you were saying, Janine, that you grew up thinking foods are good and bad. So for me, I grew up where foods were not classified as good and bad. I grew up as an what I call an attuned eater, or it goes by intuitive eating. We always had a lot of variety in the house. There were a lot of foods. There was never, I didn't have a mom who dieted. There was never diet talk. There was never any restriction on my eating. And so when I realized the havoc being caused by dieting, I had something to go back to that was very clear to me. But I don't think that's typical. And that sounds like for you that wasn't. I don't know your whole story, but yeah. You know, you're saying you grew up with good, bad food. So you're having to kind of start from scratch and really figure out, okay, so I'm not going to call foods good and bad. How do I really feel about them? Do I really like the taste? How does this feel in my body? So I really think of it as a journey. And that's why, you know, in the Diet Survivor's Handbook, we have 60 lessons so that we really break it down to like, you know, like 2 to 3 page lessons with an activity that follows each lesson so you can practice whatever concept we're teaching. Because you really have to start from scratch. Am I hungry? You know, how do you know when you're hungry? And beginning to look for a gnawing or an empty feeling that says, okay, it's time to eat. Because the 3 questions you have to answer is, am I hungry? What am I hungry for? And am I satisfied? You know, when, what, and how much. And once you're hungry, then you're in a position to figure out what you're hungry for. Now, some people might be able to relate to that idea where all of a sudden you go, oh my gosh, I need a steak and fries tonight. You know, like you just know what you're hungry for. But a lot of times people who have been dieting really just don't know how to know what they're hungry for. And so, you know, you can go through a list of things like, do I want something hot or cold? Do I want something soft or mushy or more solid or spicy or sweet or bland? And you start to narrow it down. And the key here is to think of this as experimenting. We're not going to turn this into the new diet where you have to know when you're hungry and you have to eat exactly what you're hungry for every time. If you could do that, you wouldn't be needing to learn this process. That's not how it works. So, you know, you say, okay, I'm hungry. You know, I need something kind of hot and mushy. I'm going to get, and I want something spicy, so I'm going to get a burrito. Mm-hmm. And you get the burrito, and you either say, wow, that felt great. I figured it out. And just kind of take that in, like, oh, I did it. Or you might say, you know, the hot was right and the mushy, but it turned out like the beans were just too heavy for me. It would have felt better if I had had pasta. And just note that, like you're just learning from the experience so that next time, you know, you're just registering it, you may figure it out a little more and you just begin to collect experiences. And maybe in the first week you collect 1 or 2 experiences where you're hungry and you get what you want and you start to notice, gee, that feels so much better, right? I mean, it just feels better. Well, if you're hungry and you eat something you're hungry for, and I encourage everybody right now who's listening, just think for a moment. Can you think of a time where you were hungry and you ate something that was exactly what you wanted and how that felt? And if I ask that at a workshop, people will say it felt great. It felt, I was content. I felt satisfied. And then I'll say, well, now think of a time when you were hungry and you ate something you weren't hungry for. How did that feel? It felt bad, right? It felt uncomfortable. And that's what, again, that idea of how did it feel is what's so key. If you think about it, like somebody who eats in the way I'm describing the attunement, day in and day out, you're hungry, you eat something that tastes good and feels good, you stop when you're satisfied in an hour or 3 hours or 5 hours, whenever it is, you're hungry again. You know, you repeat that throughout the day. That feels great. I have a need. I met my need. I felt satisfied compared to somebody who's really struggling with this and constantly thinking, should I eat this? Should I not? I overate. Now I feel terrible. Now I have to make up for it tomorrow. It's such, you know, can you hear the difference in the dialogue in your head? And it's draining. It takes up so much mental energy, which is why I say the goal of this work is to end the preoccupation with food and weight. It takes up so much space. And so when people really move toward the attuned eating, there's so much freedom in it.
I think it's so much more peaceful to not have that battle over, well, you know, I tune into my body and it says, yes, burrito, that's what we want right now. Instead of having that battle about, well, burritos are bad, or what are we going to do? You want this bad thing, blah, 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 back and forth, to just say, I want a burrito for this meal, and right. My body's going to handle that. It's going to be fine.
Exactly. And, you know, we talk about, like, if there's no signal to start, there's no signal to stop. So if you start eating it when you're not hungry, there's nothing to tell you you've had enough. But if you're hungry, you know, if you have a signal of hunger, at some point as you eat the burrito, there'll be a signal that says, satisfied. You know, I feel satisfied. And if you can, maybe the whole burrito is exactly what you need. Maybe two-thirds of the way through the burrito, you notice that you're feeling full, you're satisfied. And then you can start to say, oh, okay, it's safe to stop. I'm going to stop because, and I'm going to save the rest of this burrito. And if I'm hungry for it again in an hour or two or later today or tomorrow, I can go back to it. You know, it's knowing that the food will still be there. I was actually working with somebody yesterday, and she is working on giving herself permission to eat sweets. So she had gone to a place and gotten a sandwich and decided the cookies looked really good, and she got the cookie, which is great. Like, that was really different for her without yelling to just give herself permission to get the cookie. And she saved it till later in the afternoon for when she was hungry for it, which is also great. And she ate it, and she didn't have any other cookies to keep going, but she said in her head she wanted to keep going, right? She wished she had more. It felt upsetting to have to stop. So I played with this a little bit with her, and I said, you know, imagine that the cookie that you had today, you're going to have it every day in the afternoon, because she had had it in the afternoon, for the rest of your life. Does that change how you felt about stopping with the cookie? And she said, totally, because she really had had enough cookie. It's just the thought she shouldn't have one again. And once she, oh, no, no, I know what she said to me. It's actually very cute. She said, oh, I think I'm going to get bored of cookies.
Oh, yeah, I mean.
And I said, yeah, well, it doesn't have to be a cookie. You can have any other sweet you want. Oh, okay, that felt better. And she said, there might be a day I don't want one. And that's of course, exactly the point. But it was the reassurance, and that's what the word we used, that she needs to reassure herself that it's okay to stop, because whatever it is she's eating, whether it's a cookie or anything, she can have it again when she's hungry for it again. It's not going away. And if you think of kind of that, you know, diet pattern, I mean, I'm sure everybody who's dieted out there can relate to this. You're eating some cookies, you're at home, and you have a box of cookies, and you're eating, and you think, well, I'd better finish them because I'm not going to be able to have them again, right? Mm-hmm. Because you're breaking through a restraint. So I'm going to eat them all now because I'm not really supposed to have these. So, and also, if I eat them all now, I won't be tempted tomorrow.
Right.
I mean, we see that all the time. You would be better off eating the amount of cookies to satisfy your hunger, and then, you know, knowing there's more for the next time and the next time. But as I'm saying that, I think it also brings up the question to Dana, what if I can't stop? I mean, that's what people are going to struggle with. Mm-hmm. What if I can't stop?
Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering if we should
look at that definitely.
A little bit. So how do you stop? So I guess I'd say, like, you know, again, everybody's different. We've been talking about if you could start to connect it with a signal to start, give yourself permission to eat it so you're taking out the judgment, promising yourself that this food won't go away, and then it's that paying attention. But in the beginning, you are likely to overeat. Because, you know, if you think about, like, for every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. You've been depriving yourself for so long. When you start to put cookies back in your life or chips or whatever it might be, it's going to be exciting, and there's a good chance you're going to overeat. And then this is what's hard, is to not let it scare you.
Right, because, like, it's not going to stay that way forever. You're not going to want to overdo it with cookies forever. It's just that when you first take the judgment away from cookies, it's easier to eat more than maybe you're hungry for.
Exactly. So at first you might eat more than you need, but over time, and I really want to emphasize this, part of the key is to stop yelling. So a lot of times, you know, what people are doing as they're eating the cookies is saying really harsh things to themselves. Oh my gosh, here I go again. I can't believe I'm doing this. I'm out of control. I'm just, you know, what's the matter with me? I'm going to gain more weight. And they're just yelling. And that creates anxiety. And what does an anxious person do? Turns to food. And the eating keeps going. And so I really encourage people. We haven't really talked about emotional eating, you know, emotional overeating.
Mm-hmm.
And so I guess, you know, what I want to say about that for now anyway is that the deprivation is a big part of overeating for most people. At the same time, a lot of people will say that they reach for food to manage different feelings. And that's true. A lot of people are using food as a way of distracting themselves, soothing, calming, or even, you know, numbing themselves. And people, particularly with binge eating disorder, often do have other issues going on, anxiety, depression, trauma. There can be other things. And food is a way that they're trying to get through uncomfortable times. And so I try to talk a lot with people about having compassion for that. Like, when we come into this world as babies, that's the first way we're soothed, is mm-hmm. with food. Mm-hmm. And in a moment of distress, it's good that you want to help yourself. And, you know, my perspective is that food is not the worst way to go. I mean, I think people who are, you know, turning to drugs and alcohol, there's all kinds of ways people try to get through distress. And I would encourage you, you know, if you're using food in that way, to start to have compassion. I'm reaching for food and I'm not hungry. Something must be bothering me right now. Mm-hmm. And this is the best way I have to deal with it. I look forward to the day I no longer need to do that. It's really different than saying, oh my God, I can't believe you're out of control again. What's the matter with you, you big fat, whatever. You know, mm-hmm. the way people can do. You know, as a therapist, I always start with the deprivation part, because when somebody is having trouble stopping eating cookies or cake or chips or whatever, you can't really know, is it because they've decided that it's a bad food and now they've broken out of that restriction, or is something else bothering them and they're using the food to manage those feelings. And the deprivation is the, I'm putting this word in quotes, easier. I mean, it's not that it's easy, but solving the deprivation is the easier part of this work. And so as people do that, as people start to end the deprivation and then have just a lot more positive eating experiences, I'll often say when people come at the beginning, like, you know, if you have to ballpark it, how much of your eating is this attuned eating? I'm hungry, I'm making a match, I'm stopping when I'm satisfied. And people will say 0%, 5%, maybe 10%. So we work to just get that up to 50%, 60%, 70%, so that they're in a stronger position to say, I'm reaching for food and I'm not hungry. But what we've also done is built this internal structure where people can begin to trust themselves again, feel connected to themselves. Mm. When you feel connected to yourself and that you can trust yourself, you feel stronger. You feel strengthened. And when you feel strengthened, you're in a much better place to then deal with whatever the emotional stuff is.
Right.
Does that make sense to you?
Absolutely. And actually, that's a great setup to kind of segue and bring in this next aspect I wanted to ask you about. In your book, The Diet Survivor's Handbook, a lot of the end of the book is very practical information and then also practice about self-care. So I was wondering if you would tell us a little bit about the role of self-care.
Self-care can, I feel like that word gets tossed around so much these days.
It does. It does. It can sound a little cheesy now too.
But yes, you're right. We have 60 lessons in eating, acceptance, and self-care. So it's a third of the book. And the self-care ranges from things like being able to go to a doctor and get the care you need in whatever size body you have. I guess what I want to say, I want to weave in here that we really try to help people take the focus off weight loss, which is a really challenging thing to do in this culture.
Sure.
Right? I mean, it's very challenging. And in doing so, to develop practices for yourself that are sustainable. So we've been spending a lot of time talking about shifting from a diet mentality that's not sustainable to attuned or intuitive eating, really listening, using your body cues, and that's sustainable. So I guess I think of self-care as another way to think about it, is things that are sustainable for you. So it might be good sleep patterns. It might be some kind of a mindfulness or meditation practice. It may be connection with other people. You know, some of our lessons have to do with downtime. Like I'll work with a lot of women who, you know, maybe are tired at the end of the day. They've been working outside the home and now they come home and there's a lot of chores to do and they're exhausted, but they feel like they're not entitled to just slow down, right? And and just take some space. So reaching for food, if I'm eating, then I'm doing something, right? And so one example of self-care is just permission. Like, I can just stop for a while and sit on the couch or read my email or whatever is relaxing. I don't need to use food to justify that. So self-care can take, I guess what I'm trying to say is it can take so many different forms. But it's really important to notice your needs. A lot of times people who are dieters are also often like the good girl, you know, like
right.
making sure other people's needs get met and not paying attention to their own needs. And so I always love to think about attuned eating as a metaphor. You know, what am I hungry for? Not just around food, but like in life. What am I hungry for right now? I'm hungry for, let's say, connection. Okay, so the match is to reach out to a friend right now and believing I'm entitled to that. That need can be met.
Absolutely.
Those are some examples. One other thing might be even around like physical activity. Often exercise can be part of the diet mentality. I have to exercise to lose weight. And it feels like punishment. And then it's like, if I do it, I'm good. Oh, I missed some, so now I stop completely. So maybe self-care for you is really checking in with your body and noticing, what is your energy level? Do you like to move your body? What are ways to move your body that feel joyful? What are reasons to move your body if you're not moving your body for weight loss? And people can be physically active, and weight loss may be a side effect of that, and it may not. And unfortunately, when they're hooked together, sometimes people will quit. I'm exercising and I'm not losing weight. Why bother?
Right.
So for anybody listening, is there an activity that you get joy from? Or do you find that if you move in a certain way, you feel better? Or does it not fit in your life at this point? Like, you get to be back in charge of all those kind of decisions. So self-care runs the whole gamut, but it's really based in noticing your needs and honoring them as best you can, given your life circumstances.
Mm-hmm. Just trying to make that match again.
Yeah. And I think, you know, I guess that makes me want to acknowledge, like, we talk these days about privilege, and there's some parts of this, being able to afford the foods that are a match, right?
Sure.
Being able to have the time to make them, having the time to exercise. These are all things that aren't accessible to everybody. So I want to acknowledge that, and there may be limits in terms of how a particular person needs to approach this.
Sure, absolutely. I think I'm definitely trying to get better about talking about that more openly, especially on the podcast, because it's a little different than when I'm working with a client. We can have a discussion about it, but certainly, I mean, I think that that's why we have to be careful when kind of gets presented as yoga is the answer to everything, because one, it's not, and two, not everybody can do yoga, has access to that, or things like,
wants to.
Right, exactly, or things like, you know, shaming talk and language around processed foods or foods that are not organic, in addition to just there being different issues around and the environment and preference and what you're looking for food. If you're even having that thought about, should I eat organic or should I not? You already have a lot of privilege there because you get to think, you get to have that question.
Right. And I appreciate the way that you're talking about that as well.
Well, and I also wanted to point out, I just think it's such a great point that you're making about how when we prioritize our self-care and when we spend more time trying to take good care of ourselves, it makes food less of, I guess, a necessity for coping because we're meeting our needs more directly.
Mm-hmm. Yep, I agree.
What does it look like when people actually do break this diet mentality and get out of the diet and binge cycle?
It's exciting. You know, I've been doing this work for over 25 years, and sometimes it'll still bring tears to my eyes when somebody is able to come in and just talk about the freedom, the excitement, the way that they're going through life now, how much relief they feel. And I don't want to idealize it. Like, I don't want to say that once somebody, it's not like you get it once and then it's never an issue again. I'm just thinking of one person I've worked with for a couple of years where has gone from the diet mentality, restriction, binging, to most of the time just enjoying her food. And every so often she'll have a moment, you know, she'll have a time where she eats in a way that now feels so weird to her. It used to be what was normal, but where she either eats too much or eats when she's not hungry. And then it becomes an opportunity for her to look at, hey, what just happened here? So instead of seeing it as bad or scary, it just becomes an opportunity to say, what's up? Oh my gosh, things got so busy, I didn't even get to the grocery store this week. I let things run out, and when I let things run out, I can't meet my needs, you know?
Right.
So I was just grabbing something. Or something happened at work today, and it was really upsetting, and I turned to food. And instead of then it becoming something, you know, that's now going to become a pattern, it's like, oh, I get it. I was more upset about that than I realized, and I really need to talk about my experience and put it into words. And, you know, so it's not that there's one way it looks. There's incredible freedom for people. People come back to seeing food as a source of nourishment and pleasure. And I was actually talking with another client the other day. We were talking about how, you know, it's still hard when there's all this diet talk around her.
Yep.
You know, she was at an event. And, you know, it was really frustrating. She tried to change the subject, and that didn't work. But she said she doesn't absorb it anymore. I mean, it's still really hard to listen to, but she doesn't absorb it. And then we talked about how that idea of even kind of feeling sorry for people who are still stuck in it. And I don't mean that in an insulting way to anybody who's out there, but when you find the freedom from this, when you realize that eating can just be integrated in a calm, pleasurable, peaceful way, you start, the diet talk takes on a different feeling for you. Instead of joining in, you're noticing, you've become the one to notice, wow, don't they see the pattern? They lose it. They feel good now. But what's going to happen in a few months? Or I feel bad for them. Everybody's enjoying a piece of cake for dessert for the birthday. And I can see they want it and they won't let themselves have it. Mm. And that's painful. You know, so that's sort of part of the transition as you're moving from diet mentality to feeling in charge. I always talk about the difference between being in charge of eating versus being in control. Like being in control is dieting, right? I have willpower. I'm going to make myself not eating it. Being in charge is I get to decide, yeah, I'm in the mood for that birthday cake today, or no, thank you, I'm not hungry for it. And it's not a deprivation, and it's not because it's bad. It's just because I really just don't want it right now.
I love that distinction in charge versus in control. I really like that. I'm totally going to use that with my clients now.
You know, we have, in Beyond a Shadow of a Diet, we have a really, I don't know if you've looked at it, Janine, but there's a really nice list of it's in our second edition, the 2014 edition, of the difference between diet mentality and attuned eating. And that's the last one on our list, is in charge, in control versus in charge. But there's like 10 or 15 of them to kind of help you tell the difference. So, yeah.
That's wonderful.
And you can make that into a handout. So, yeah.
Wonderful.
But I also think, you know, the really hard part of this, I'm going to bring it back to weight, because that's the reason people go on a diet in the first place, is to try to lose weight. And so the question of, well, if I quit dieting, what will happen with my weight? The honest answer is nobody knows.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, some people will see weight loss as a side effect of ending their binging and changing their behaviors, and some people won't. And if some people have been restricting when they start, they might gain weight, and they would have gained it anyway when the diet, you know, stopped. So it really depends. And then people have to deal with, you know, I used to call it body image, and I still, of course, do, but I really think more these days about all the weight stigma out there, all the terrible messages about fat, about body size, that are not based in fact, but all the fat shaming that goes on. And those messages have been internalized by just about everybody. And so I think of it as the internalized weight stigma that people have to do.
Mm.
And I think it's really important, you know, if you're on this journey, if you're listening today, if you're already on this path of quitting diets, or if you're listening today and you're going to start by, like, maybe looking at the Diet Survivor's Handbook and saying, how do I even, you know, where do I start? It is important to get support along the way. And your podcast is a great example of that support, of giving different messages. There's a lot of podcasts out there. There's some really good Facebook groups. There's all kinds of, you know, besides books we've written, there's all kinds of wonderful books. And sometimes people find that they're not able to do this on their own. And especially if you're dealing with some other kinds of psychological issues that may be impacting your journey, you might want to seek professional help. A therapist or sometimes a dietitian can be helpful.
Mm-hmm.
Now, sometimes, certainly, they can be helpful. So just, it depends. I guess what I mean is it depends where your focus is.
Sure,
sure. Who you might turn to. And again, we get back to, you know, having the resources to be able to do that. But in my experience, when people who decide to go on this journey, it looks different for everybody. But people begin to see changes pretty quickly in their eating patterns.
Mm-hmm. And you think there's hope?
There is absolutely hope.
Yeah.
I know that there is hope. But again, you know, there are parts of the journey that are the same for everybody. I've talked about some things today, you know, how the deprivation makes you want things better. Everybody who's been through the diet binge cycle knows these things. That's the great part of being a therapist doing this work, is everybody's story is different. It's never boring, because even though some parts are the same, everybody's journey is so unique. You know, what they learned in their family growing up, what they were told about their body and their weight, you know, the messages they got, what the psychological issues are that you know, affect the eating, and on and on. And so for some people, this can go, you know, I've seen this go really quickly, a matter of months that they work their way through it. And some people, it's years. It just depends on your own story. But absolutely, there's hope. And, you know, I encourage people to reach out if they need to find somebody who uses a non-diet approach. And I haven't used this phrase today, but who who uses a health at every size approach. Health at every size is simply the name of a paradigm that focuses on well-being rather than weight. It also addresses the social justice issues related to body size in this culture.
Absolutely. We are a Health at Every Size podcast for sure. So I will, again, link your books in the show notes. And then if people want to reach out or connect with you, where can they find you?
The best way to do that would be go to my website, www.judithmatz.com, and you'll be able to find resources there. I have a media page that have all of the, I've written a lot of articles and blogs on, you know, different parts of this and some other podcasts, so you're welcome to find those resources. I also do a lot of public speaking, and so if anybody's part of an organization looking for a speaker, please contact me. If you're in the Chicago area, I'm available for counseling. But my website will have all of that information.
I will link that in the show notes as well. Of course, Judith, thank you so much for your time today. What an illuminating conversation. You clearly, concisely, compassionately talked about an issue that is so complex. And I think a lot our listeners have so much to think about. So thank you for being here.
Well, thank you for having me.
Thanks for joining me for another episode. Let's keep in touch. You can find all the information you need about the podcast at eatingdisorderrecoverypodcast.com, including full podcast episodes and links to all of our social media sites. You can join our Facebook group for the podcast by searching Eating Disorder Recovery Podcast on Facebook. This is a closed group for listeners of the podcast looking to connect, share resources, and get involved in a pro-recovery community. Don't forget to subscribe to the podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, SoundCloud, or YouTube. Please leave us a review and let us know how we're doing. Talk to you next time on the Eating Disorder Recovery Podcast.